de la hair.
Now, do you gain eternal life? According to the main verses of Scripture, the bedrock, the teaching verses, well, let's just see. Now, Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says this. For the wages, okay, the wages, and the Greek word for wages is asonia, okay, asonia, of sin, okay, harmatias, is death. That's the wages. If you want to work for it, that's the wage. It says, but the, ta de, the free gift, the charisma, or the charisma, okay, the charisma to Theu, la charisma to Theu, the free gift of God, or the God over here, is life eternal, Zoe, okay, Ionios. That's, is a, you can't gain it, it's a free gift. Okay, go ahead.
Philippians 3:8 out of the American Standard Version. Yea, verily, and I count all things to be lost for the excelling excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but refuse, that I may gain Christ. The Greek word is kurdaino, which means Greek word study, translated to pronunciation, that the entomology and grammar and Thayer's all say to gain. That's what the Greek word means, kurdaino, to gain. So, he goes on to say, and be found in union with him, not because of my own righteousness from following the law, but because of the righteousness that is through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. My aim is to know him and the power of his resurrection and to share his sufferings, submitting myself to a death like his, to see if at all possible I may attain to the earlier resurrection. Not that I have already received it or I'm already made perfect, but I am pressing on to see if I may also lay hold on that for which Christ Jesus selected me. Paul talks about laying hold of, seeking, pressing forward towards, so that we can gain the Christ and gain everlasting life.
It doesn't say that in the text, everlasting life.
Through the Christ. Gain everlasting life through the Christ. Not through the works of the Mosaic Law, not through works of the flesh, but works of faith, which is what James talked about. Faith without Christian works are dead. Or is dead. I believe we're all dead here. I want to gain the Christ. That's what I'm trying to do, gain the Christ, and I'm pressing forward so that I may lay hold of it. That's what Jehovah's Witnesses are doing. They're trying to gain the Christ. It's right here in the Scriptures, the Greek word.
And you'll never find him, because the thing is, you're trying to grab onto water, okay, the wrong way. You can get water in least two, you can get it in millions of ways, but you can get water two ways. You turn on the faucet, okay, and then you reach out your hand, and then you try to grab the water from the faucet and you try to drink. But there's a better way, though. It's that you take a cup that God gave you, okay, and he placed in your hand, you put the cup under the faucet, you turn on the water, and you drink, okay? Taste and see that the Lord is gracious. He will not give his glory to another, Isaiah. He will not give the glory to you. If you say that you gain it, now everything that he said is in the Christian life, that and you see spelled out what you can gain. And it gives you two chapters. The chapters in Revelation chapter 2 and Revelation, which talks about four churches, and Revelation chapter 3, you have there rewards. That's the only thing that you can gain as a Christian are crowns. The crown of life. And that he doesn't take your name out of the book of life, that you don't die early as a Christian. After that, there's nothing else that you can gain. That it even gives
you. Okay, then I make the end of Christ. I mean, it's right there, black and white. I don't know how else to read that.
I'm
saying to myself, man, I want to get into Christ.
Well, how else to read that is to harmonize that verse with all the passages that a Christian can get, things that Christians can gain. A new name in the temple of God, as one of the churches in the book of Revelation. The crowns that are cast, even in the feet of Christ. So the crowns that you gain are even going to be at the feet of Christ, because it wasn't you that gained them anyway. That's where you're going to throw them. You're going to throw them at the feet of Christ. The manna. Ah, that's another reward. Okay? All right? So all of these things, you can say, listen, Paul says not to work. In verse 5 of chapter 4 of Romans, it says clearly, to the man who does not work, but believes. But then he says in chapter 2 of verse 13, not the hearers of the law shall be justified, but by the doers of the law shall be justified. So what's the deal? So then you go, this is the thing, to read the whole book. You don't come with an interpretation out of one verse of scripture. You just don't do it. Now, what he does, is that after saying the doers of the law shall be justified, then he goes in just in case you get the wrong idea, in verse 20 of chapter 3, the same book, he just said that the doers of the law shall be justified. In verse 13, I'm even giving you a break. I'm bringing it up. He didn't even bring it up. Romans chapter 2, verse 13 says that the doers of the law shall be justified. And then he comes in Romans chapter 3, verse 20, the doer, and he says, that you're not going to be justified by the law. So what's the deal? Well, then you go and keep on reading. And when you keep on reading, this is a giant jigsaw puzzle, the Word of God, because one guy tells you that you can be saved by works, seemingly so, and then another person says you can't. So what's the deal? Well, you have to keep on reading. Well, it says over here, let me just read in the NASB, okay, to sum up the whole issue. It says over here, where then is boasting? Is it, okay, it is excluded by what kind of law? See, that's very important in the NASB. By what kind of law? Of works? No, but by a law of faith. Bingo, right there. So let me try to finish this off. This is very important over here. So when you give me verses like James 2:17, and you didn't even give me, I gave you.
I know.
Romans 2:13. No, wait a minute. Romans 2:13, and then it says very clearly over here that the law that he's talking about in Romans chapter 2 verse 13 is not the law of works or the Ten Commandments, but the law of faith. That's how you say faith.
But that's
the thing. But you can't be saved by your works. Now, before
you keep saying I can't. What? But let's keep it off the scriptures for a second, Andrew. Why do you keep saying I can't?
Because God says he can't.
I'm a guy who picks up the Word of God every single day, just about, and reads it and rereads it and continues to read it. And I'm telling you.
I'm telling you.
When I read Philippians chapter 3, Paul says that I might gain the Christ and then I'm pressing forward.
Yeah, he said that as a Christian, though.
That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to gain the Christ.
But the problem is you're trying to gain him, but you're not a Christian, though. See, that's the thing. That's why you can't do it. You're never going to do it because you're not a Christian, though. That's the thing. See, Paul was a Christian, and you're not a Christian, though. See, that's why you can't gain. See, you can't be filled with the fullness of God. And Ephesians chapter 3 says very clearly that you can be filled with all the fullness of God. It's not that you're a Mormon, that you're a God. But it's just that, see, that's the thing that you can gain. See, that's the thing that he was praying for the Ephesian church, to know the length, the depth, the height.
Did I hear you right? Did you just say that I'm not a Christian?
Any person who boasts in his goodness or what he can do to try to work for eternal life is not either one of two things. Okay, I'll make it even more clear.
You didn't hear me. I'll say it again. We are not working our way to eternal life. We are showing appreciation for the life that was given us Well, by going and doing what Jesus said in Matthew 28:19-20. Go therefore and make disciples, teaching them all the things that I have observed or told you to observe.
Okay.
And look, I am with you all the days until the conclusion of the
Okay, so let's go to one of the things that he taught that you deny. Okay, so you're saying
I still
that
have to read 1 John.
Well, first of all, this is very important. I mean, this is you're saying that you love the Lord Jesus and you're saying that you obey him, but when he says something, then you follow Charles Taze Russell and you don't believe.
Tell me what he said.
This is what he said. Okay. Now, in John chapter 2, verse 19, it says over here this. Jesus.
All right, let me get that.
Okay.
Let me get that.
Okay, go ahead.
John 2:19?
John 2:19, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So now.
Let me get that. I'm almost there.
Okay, no, that's all right. Verse 19, Jesus answered and said to the. Okay. Verse 19, chapter 2 says this. Now you are going on and on and on and saying that you have to, that you obey the Lord Jesus, that you love the Lord Jesus, that you're trying to gain him and stuff like that. So let's get the Watchtower Society out of the way for now, okay?
I've been trying to do that the whole conversation. I just want to talk about the scriptures.
Okay. So let's talk about the scriptures. It says, John 2:19, it says, Jesus answered and said to them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. Now, this is the contention I have with the Jehovah's Witnesses, okay? Is that, and I'm just going to say this as quick as I can, and you can explain it or whatever you want to do. I mean, I've just listen. The Jehovah's Witnesses hold the teaching by Charles Taze Russell that the man Christ Jesus is dead forever dead, volume 5, page 455.
Now, Angelo, can I ask one question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Can we forget about the Jehovah's Witnesses? Say, I'm one of Jehovah's Witnesses. You're talking to one. Why don't you just tell me how you view the verse, and then I'll tell you, as one of Jehovah's Witnesses, how I view the verse. Can we do that?
Okay, first of all, let me just speak. You know, I don't tell you how to speak, so I'm just trying to give you... Yeah, but I'm trying to give you a broader context of what I'm trying to say. You're not going to understand it if I don't give you a capsulized version of what the Watchtower Society teaches, and you're making the conversation longer. I'm trying to say and trying to get to the point. Now
I know what they do, though.
John chapter 2, verse 19. Okay. John chapter 2, verse 19 and 21 says very clearly that when Jesus is put to death, the same, let me just finish, okay? The same body is going to come out of the grave, okay? Not that Jehovah is going to destroy it. Not that it's going to be, vaporized or pulverized or whatever. None of that. Not that it's going to go to its primary elements and they say not be corrupted, but it's going to be corrupted if it goes anywhere. Anyway, doesn't matter. So Psalm 16, verse 10 says very clearly that you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption. Now, if the flesh of Jesus is destroyed, it's going to see corruption. It's going to see corruption. That's all there is to it. Now, this is my beef, okay? Jesus Christ said something, okay? The Watchtower Society disagrees and says that he's a spirit creature, but that was before, but that he was raised in different forms and he didn't have a physical body. And by the way, how can Mary Magdalene hold on to him if he was a spirit a creature, by the way? So that's just another thing. And it even says that in your translation that why do you cling on to me, which is a good translation of the Greek, by the way, and they shot themselves in the foot in translating it right. Why you keep on clinging on to me? So he wasn't a spirit at all. He had a body. Mary Magdalene was holding on to him. And well, this is my beef. If Psalm 16 verse 10 says that he's not going to see corruption, and it says very clearly that it says it destroy this temple and in three days I will raise it up again, the same body, it, okay?